and I don't want to lie in church. I also told that joke this morning, and it went just as well. Okay. Oh, I'm going to move this. Hang on. I don't think I need a step stool. Let's go to God in prayer. Good and gracious God, as we are led in worship by the smallest among us, let us be thankful. Let us be thankful for the tiny inhales and exhales against our chest as our newborns, exhausted from life, fall deep asleep, if only for a few sweet moments. Let us be thankful for quiet giggles and booming laughter ringing through our homes as we play and grow together. Let us be thankful as our children turn from babies into little people right in front of our eyes. Help us to learn from our children's resilience and loving hearts. Help us to learn from their powerful screams and their questions that make us stop short in our tracks. God, quiet our hearts today. Dwell in this holy space. Intercede my inadequate words and transform them as they enter the hearts of your people. It is in your holy name we pray. Amen. Dad, Dad, Isaac called out, skipping behind his father. Abraham slows his pace, trembling a bit. Tears already in his eyes, throat caught, he avoids the boy's glance. Dad, the chipper boy pipes up, tottering around with the wood in his hands, so proud to be going with his father to build the altar. It's a real boy's trip, right? Dad, where's the lamb? We can't do the offering without the lamb. Abraham tries to quiet his mind. The Lord will provide for us a lamb. They approach the top of the mountain, and maybe they stop to watch the sunrise. And then Isaac probably fetched the materials for his dad. Happily, and then together, they built the altar. Father and son. And as Abraham embraced his son with the completion of the altar, he held on a bit too tight. Dad, I can't breathe. Dad, you're hurting me. Dad, I can't move. What are you doing? Both sets of eyes full of tears. Isaac's tears of terror and betrayal. Confusion as to why the person he loves most in the world is holding a knife above his heart. Abraham's tears are tears of painful obedience. God wants his child. With trembling hands, sweat dripping from his brow, Abraham raises the knife above his head, and just as he is about to send the blow of death, he hears, "Abraham, no. Not like this. You have already shown that this child is the Lord's. Do not lay a hand on that child. Do not lay a hand on that child." God stayed the father of our faith from choosing the all too common violent solution. God desired the full potential of Isaac's life rather than a sacrificial death. Although Abraham sought to obey, he failed to learn the heart of the God he served. God yearns that we see the value of his promise alive in children. Yet all too frequently, we choose our own well-being over the care and protection of God's kingdom promised in the children of the world. So what does it mean for us today to listen to God's call to stay our hand? I've lived and worked with children in both Uganda and Indonesia, and I have seen the poverty. I have seen starving children. I have seen homeless children. I have seen abused children. This summer, one of my Ugandan students was kidnapped on her way home from school. She woke up later drugged, hearing her captors talking distantly above her. No, not this one. She's not perfect. She woke up again on the side of the road and crawled her way to safety. Because of a blemish or some sort of physical imperfection, she was spared. But she was literally kidnapped for child sacrifice. And this reality should remind us that we also sacrifice children in seemingly less dramatic ways when we deny them education, food, water, safety, when we deny them an opportunity for the future. A simple look around reveals that we repeatedly fail to heed God's stay of our hand. But I've also seen really hopeful things. And so today I want to talk to you about three children that I know that are surviving the knife of violence and are living proof of God's promise for the kingdom. And hopefully through these stories, you might feel a little bit of connection and responsibility that God has placed on our lives for all of his children. Berani Bayikati Binting. That's Indonesian for brave, kind-hearted, and important. As I knelt at the table with 12-year-old Sandra, we were working on an English assignment. And this child was 12, but she looked 8 because of malnourishment. And the English assignment was to give me 3 words to describe yourself. And she chose brave, kind-hearted, and important. She was new to the Foundation for Loving Children, which is a group home for street children that I was living at the time. And as a general story of the Balinese street child, these adolescent children, probably usually 6 to 12, are sent from their homes in the village to the tourist towns of Kuta. And that's sometimes hours. They're sent to live in these tourist towns to beg for money to provide for their family. So they beg or they sell bracelets to rich white people like us, and they become the primary source of income for their entire family. The food that their brothers and sisters eat depends on them, a 6-year-old. And education, it's not an option. And I want to tell you that this is what child sacrifice looks like today. And their caretakers in these tourist towns, they might as well be called pimps, because they take at least 80% of what the child earns. And if a child doesn't meet a quota, they're left on the street for the night without dinner. And if they're left on the street for the night and the police see them, the police are going to corral them in the back of a truck, and they're going to drive them for hours out into the middle of nowhere, and they're going to leave them there. And the kids are going to have to find their way back because they don't know where else to go. And so it's an endless cycle of violence from all angles. But for Sandra, sacrifice isn't any longer her reality, because the founder of the group, a woman named Ibu Putu, found her and fed her, sent her to school, and gave her a safe, warm bed at night. But can you imagine the strength that it might take to consider yourself important after literally everyone in your life has treated you like you have no value? And I wonder if the fact that one woman took the time to look her in the eye and say that your life is precious and you deserve a future, I wonder if that one event gave this little girl the strength to claim her own importance. I have to wonder if Ibu Putu heard the voice of God calling out for no hand to be laid upon this child. Did she understand the importance that no child should be offered up as a sacrificial lamb for the family? This summer in Uganda, I lived at a Catholic parish, and I worked at the primary school just a stone's throw away. And it was there that another 12-year-old started working on my heart. Being a teacher that lived on campus, it pretty much meant that I was available all the time, which really just means that I'm available all the time for someone to come and borrow my soccer ball. So one day when Clement, my favorite student, was returning my soccer ball, he said, I'm really sorry, there's a rip in the stitching. I said, Clement, it's okay, I don't care. And he said, I'm just so sorry. And then he came back a few days later and he said, I promise that when I raise the money, I'll come and I'm gonna fix the ball. And I looked at him kind of confused and he said, it's gonna take a little while, but once I get the money, I'm gonna come and I'm gonna fix it. And I asked him how much it was gonna be. He said 2,000 shillings. And I paused and made this huge fuss about how it would be really great if I could give him the money right now, if he could take it and fix it because it was my ball in the first place. And he did, happily. And later invited me to visit his home. So I went with him and his grandma greeted me in her finest green dress. And she whisked me inside and she sat me down on a mat on the floor and she poured me a warm glass of milk and served me fried bread. And we laughed and talked about Clement and his family for about an hour. And as I left, she gave me this beautiful floor mat that she had woven herself. It was a great day. And here are some important details about Clement's life. He lost his mother and his brother from illness, and his father has all but abandoned him. Clement lives in a one-room house with no electricity or running water, and it is smaller than my bedroom. Clement has also lived every day of his life with HIV. So to be clear, an HIV-positive, barefoot child who has to fetch water from a well on a regular basis and hand wash his own clothes offered to me the equivalent of 75 cents to fix my soccer ball, and I don't even like soccer. So if you're looking to talk about a reality check of epic proportions, I am your girl. I learned this summer that I do not, by any standard of measurement, understand how to love like Jesus is calling me to love. But that day, I saw in Clement, not Christ the suffering servant, but a glimpse of the kingdom of God. I witnessed an economy of abundance in a child. Childlike faith means that there is enough if we are working together for the good. I saw Christ in a child asking me to participate in something new. And Clement affected me so much that I came home and I preached a sermon on this radical hospitality. And after that sermon, someone was so touched by his overwhelming generosity and hospitality that Clement now has a sponsor for his education. Someone decided that it was time to stay the hand of poverty and oppression that was continuously coming down on that little boy. And I am grateful. Compassion International statistics on human trafficking tells us that between 600,000 and 800,000 human beings are trafficked between international borders annually, and 50% of those are minors. Worldwide, 6 million children are living in, or 600 million children are living in extreme poverty. The cost of eradicating world poverty is estimated at 1% of global income. 6.9 million children under 5 years of age died in 2011. That is nearly 800 children every hour. And this might seem unnecessary, but I'm gonna stretch this out a little bit. 41,600 children under the age of 5 died during this 11 o'clock worship hour in 2011. So if the statistics have remained the same since then, that is roughly 145,000 child deaths during the worship hour since 2011. That is 800 children dying right now. Right now, as we are thanking God for our gifts and celebrating with our own children, our own healthy children. And every week as we pray, God, your will be done, we sometimes like to think that that means that God's will is being done. And we comfort ourselves with the notion that God is in control over the good and the bad. And we sometimes try and explain the death of a child as the will of God. But when that child could have been saved by something as simple as clean water or access to adequate, not even exceptional, health care, to me, saying that this death is God's will or that there is some greater purpose just seems like bad theology. And I say this because God has been telling us from the beginning that no, God does not desire the death of Isaac. God desires the life of Isaac. We look at suffering families all over the world and we tell them that through suffering comes strength, and to suffer is a test from God, and we wipe our hands clean of the mess that it makes to stand up and loudly say no. No to the world's ideas of an economy of scarcity in which we do not believe we have enough to distribute our wealth among the poor. No to the world's idea that if you face challenges of oppression and work hard enough, then you will be rewarded for your efforts. And if you fail, it is because you were not faithful enough or obedient enough or driven enough. No to the world's suggestion that wealth is a sign of God's favor and poverty or tragedy is a sign of God's wrath or testing. No to accepting evil and death in the world when giving our time and our resources back to God will literally change someone's life. There is no such thing as a task too big for a God who created, redeemed, and sustains us. Vivian will be 12 in November. And because I made a snap and perhaps financially questionable decision 5 years ago to sponsor a Compassion International child, that 12-year-old can go to the doctor anytime she needs. She can afford to go to school. Her mother has received job training. And her family has a room to rent that's very near to her school and her church. But Vivian is not an exceptional child, and I am not an exceptional sponsor. She is not a particularly good student, and I really, really forget to write her letters. But she is happy, and she is healthy, and she has a roof over her head at night. And this isn't because I'm doing anything exceptionally good, but because I made a small commitment to give back to God what was already God's, and God has moved with it. And I wouldn't have known that if I didn't have the opportunity to meet Vivian for myself. I wouldn't have realized just how much God does when I'm too busy to pay attention. But hugging her and seeing her and looking at this huge book of all the things that have happened in the past 5 years made me realize just how much I don't do. And just how much God does, and that's really important. That's really humbling, and it's really important. It's important to know that I unknowingly had God grab a hold of my hand as God whispered, "Let not a hand be laid on this child. I will provide." We are not meant to simply be compassionate witnesses to poverty and suffering in the world. We are called to join the kingdom of God that is here and now. Like Vivian, there are millions of children of God living in extreme poverty that deserve a chance to live out their lives. We are called to participate in restoration. We are called to stay the hand of violence and child sacrifice in this world. And why does our vision of the world prevent us from taking action? We are called to participate in restoration, not be bystanders to destruction and the powers of death. How do we invest in the promise of Isaac in a world that is continually wielding its knife? When we turn a blind eye to child suffering, we are actively choosing to dismiss that childhood is essential to a holistic view of the Imago Dei. What does it mean to be made in the image of God? It means to be born a child. Being made in the image of God Triune means being created in relationship and for relationship. And what did that look like for Jesus? What did it look like for the Redeemer to be born into the world and live as a child? To answer this question, we have to consider Mary. Mary, the mother of God, was probably no more than 14 years old. God incarnate chose to live inside of an unmarried child. What does it mean that God chose to literally live inside of a child? God dwelled inside of Mary and then was born a child to be cared for by what we would consider a child. What this tells us is that children are essential to the world. They are critical in the story of Jesus. A child brought God into the world. A child bore the Word, and then a child was the Word. Jesus came into this world as a fugitive, fleeing from state-sanctioned persecution of children. So too are children all over the world, particularly children in poverty, still 2,000 years later being sold into slavery, denied the right to education, shamed publicly for early pregnancies, even when that pregnancy was a result of violence, starved to death, beaten and abused. And we, from our perspective of privilege, sometimes like to claim that this is God's will, because we know that if we took the gospel seriously, we would have to change our comfortable lives radically. When we let a child die of starvation or dehydration or preventable disease, when we separate mother and child with deportation, destroying relationships and putting scared children at risk, we are letting the world kill Christ over and over again. We are breaking the body every minute of every day, and God is weeping for those children. God is weeping in the death of the body. God is not simply a father who sacrificed his son for the sake of others, but God was the crucified one. This same God that could not let Abraham sacrifice his child chose to reconcile the world in a radical way. God took on flesh and came into the world as a child. God walked among us, and we called him Jesus. Jesus had parents who knew that the powers of evil were chasing him from the time of his birth, and they fled to safety in Egypt. They became illegal immigrants, all in order to protect their child from suffering and persecution established and sanctioned by the state. And Jesus got to live for us. God became incarnate in order to experience life among us, and we killed him for it. So that's what I want to say when God is with us. When I say that God is with us, and when we say that God is with us, that's what it means, that God came to live a life with us. And we ask in heartbreaking situations, where is God? Or we say that all too common, but those terribly damaging words to a grieving mother, that this was God's plan. We forget that God is not dancing in the sky as our hearts are breaking, but instead God is being broken too. On the cross, God's body is beaten and broken, and every Sunday we break the body of Christ again and again, and God grieves. God felt loneliness and abandonment, and we hear that Jesus cried out in frustration, my God, why have you forsaken me? This God came to earth to be with human beings in all stages of life, including death. Then Jesus cried again with a loud voice and breathed his last. At that moment, the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth shook and the rocks split. God loves God's creation. And when creation grieves, God grieves too. So to make this point clearly, it is an earth-shattering event when any child of God suffers and dies. This is what I truly believe is the point of the father-son metaphor for the God the Creator and God the Redeemer. This is what we learn in Matthew. We see the emotion and the trauma of violence and death, and we see God crying out in pain for the forsaken. And at the same time, we know that it is God on the cross because we believe and confess that God is triune and that Jesus is the Word made flesh. God did not abandon Jesus, sacrificing God's son in Isaac's stead. God was on that cross, reconciling the world through life-giving blood, because God is life-giving, creator, redeemer, sustainer. And there are so many women and children in the world today that suffer in silence because of theologies that tell us that to be like Christ means to bear our crosses, and that any suffering counts as a cross to bear. And what I really want to suggest to you is that the cross that Jesus bore was a specific one. Jesus was crucified because he was a threat to the established order of the world. So if we want to bear our crosses, we do not suffer in silence as we are being starved or beaten or abused, and we do not let others suffer in silence as they are being starved or beaten or abused. We do not give up our sense of self-worth and call it self-sacrifice, and we do not demand others to give up their senses of self-worth and call it self-sacrificing. Instead, we look at the powers in the world that are perpetuating injustice and dealing death, and we say no more. That is the cross that Jesus bore. So in our world, how can we be more like Jesus? How can we live lives that demand justice for the weak? How might we disrupt world order in order to participate in the reality that Jesus gives us? Maybe we should look to the protective nature of Jesus's parents. Mary and Joseph not only stayed the hand of violence that was seeking out the godchild, but they fled from it. They knew not to suffer in silence when the world could not hear God calling out, "No, not like this." When we look into the faces of our children, we should see God at work. We should see the image of Christ living in the pregnant child, in the starving child, in the beaten child, in the happy child, in the terrible two, in the child with the learning disability, in the child who takes her anger out on others. We should see God everywhere we turn, in the broken and the beautiful. We should weep when Christ is seven and sold into slavery. We should weep when God is orphaned and left to raise her three small siblings, still a child herself. We should weep when a child goes to bed hungry at night. And then, through those holy tears, we should lunge together at the hand of violence in the world, crying, "No more. You will not lay a hand on that child." Amen.